A message. A message for the governments of the world's states. For delegates attending the UN Climate Change Conference in Paris at the end of 2015. Without water, soil, solar energy, and natural greenhouse gases, life on continents cannot exist. By putting an end to the draining of our continents, we can stop the overheating of continents by solar radiation, stop global warming, stop the melting of glaciers and ice caps, stop the rising of the ocean levels, stop floods, stop droughts, stop the decreasing of groundwater levels, stop the drying out of streams and rivers, stop landslides. Our solution can stop climate change. There is a verified solution. A solution which is immediately effective and sustainable. In the summer of 2009, at this place, at the bottom of the nearly empty river Ush, I began to wonder how it was possible that there was so little water in the river. With average annual precipitation levels almost unchanged, where had it gone? Laws of physics have to apply, I thought. The water is in the oceans. Why does the water run off so quickly, when neither the profile nor the inclination of the riverbed has changed in the recent years? I thought back to the times I've spent in the mountains timbering, logging, and building forest roads both in summer and winter. I recollected that water was always absorbed by the soil even during heavy rainfall or snowmelt. It never ran along the surface, except for the places where the soil was compressed by tractors and other heavy machinery. There, the water was no longer absorbed by the soil. It was streaming down concrete ditches and riverbeds, walled in by tall dikes, into the oceans, muddy, as it was taking away the forest soil too. In the past, it would have taken days or even months for the amount of water which flows through the riverbed in just a few hours today to pass along the same stretch of the stream, as then the rivers were constantly fed by groundwater sources. Today, when rainwater falls on compressed soil, it immediately runs off to streams and rivers, filling them quickly and flowing off. Standing by the almost empty river Ush, I also started to wonder why all this is happening now and why it hasn't happened some 30 or 50 years ago. And I started to realize that it cannot be due to the often mentioned climate change. Climate change cannot be blamed for floods, droughts, landslides, lower river or groundwater levels, or global warming. We are the ones to be blamed, as we are increasing the speed at which water runs off from continents into oceans. In the past 6 years, I have traveled across Europe monitoring floods in 16 countries. All of them follow the same scenario and had the same cause. Water, which we allowed to run off from the woods too quickly, is flooding populated areas, and floods are followed by droughts. My observations led me to one conclusion. all those countries were using the same logging and agricultural methods, and all of them were making the same mistakes. So what are the mistakes we are all making? We are draining lowland areas with draining channels. We are compressing soil in forests and fields uncontrollably. We are disrupting natural profiles of hills and create man-made slopes. We are doing this with staggering speed on all continents. The land is then heated by the sun, which subsequently heats up the Earth's atmosphere, and the cycle keeps on repeating itself faster and faster with growing intensity. The biggest problem, in fact, is that the sun is heating up drained lands excessively. The air heated up by the overheated lands rises and is trapped due to greenhouse gases. In order for us to understand the entire issue better, it is important to realize the following. According to scientific research, 1 cubic meter of intact soil in Central Europe holds about 200 to 500 liters of water. Soil is thus an essential drinking water reservoir designed by nature. Water in soil can be found in pores. It circulates through a natural branch distribution system, feeding roots of plants, sources of water streams, and groundwater reservoirs. If we compress soil, we compress pores that are in it and destroy the system. The natural cycle is thus broken. A similar thing happens when we disconnect the system mechanically. Then, the natural irrigation system turns into a drainage system, allowing for the irreversible runoff of water from the soil, gradually draining the land. In other words, if we collapse pores present in the soil, water cannot be soaked up. If we break up pore continuity, water will flow out of the soil. And this is how it works in practice. Agricultural land, lowlands. Until the 1980s, the majority of European countries used the same methods to cultivate agricultural land. Harvests were followed by deep plowing, and soil was prepared for autumn and spring sowing. Machines only rarely went to the sowed areas during growing seasons, thanks to which rainwater was able to soak into the uncompressed soil. In the last 30 years, however, compressing of agricultural soil has increased thanks to new technologies and efforts to minimize agricultural costs. In spring and autumn, soil is prepared for a 10 to 18 centimeter deep sowing. Crops are just sown only in a thin upper layer with a thick layer of compressed soil beneath it. The first time when tractors compress soil is during the actual sowing. Later, they return to the fields to spray the crops and fertilize them, and the already compressed layer gets compressed even more. The rainwater which falls in such fields soaks the top cultivated layer of the soil, yet the compressed layer underneath retains only a minimum amount of water. The remaining water runs off to lower areas, taking along fertile soil too. When crops sprout, machines go back to the fields both in spring and autumn. They start fertilizing and the compressing cycle goes on. When it rains, the situation happening after sowing occurs again, yet this time, water runs off from a much larger area. The water which does not soak into the ground in hilly landscapes immediately runs off to the nearest channel or brook. In lowlands, the water runs off quickly along furrows into channels and via rivers into oceans. A few hours after the rain, these channels and brooks are empty again. Even though some of the water forms lakes in the lower parts of fields and it can look like the soil is thoroughly soaked, the fact is that the underlying compressed layer of soil does not let the water soak through. As soon as the crops are about 30 centimeters tall, the entire fertilizing and compressing process is repeated. Muddy water keeps flowing off of the fields, washing up arable land. On fields with greater inclination, it frequently happens that clear water is running off of them, as the arable land located on the surface after performing agricultural activities has already been washed off into the dams and oceans. Fields become rocky and subsequently less fertile. The process of spraying, sprinkling, and of massive compressing of soil continues as long as crops are growing. And then comes the harvest. As a result of all of this, some fields are no longer able to absorb water aerially. Here we can see a blooming oilseed rape field and an uncultivated cornfield. In winter and in spring, a large amount of snow water runs off this area instead of soaking into the ground. Fields like these were one of the major causes of the 2014 floods in the United Kingdom. In the 1940s, draining channels started to be built in Slovak lowlands. They cause water, which has soaked into the fields, to flow out through broken pores through channel walls, leaving the channel empty. Surrounding fields are thus drained as deep as the bottom of the channel. It is from this period that climatologists have started to note a major increase in the Earth's surface temperature. Another diagram shows how the compressed layer of soil fails to let rainwater soak into the ground, quickly draining it along the surface into the channel instead. Since human activities led to the draining of rainwater from agricultural land, groundwater levels are dropping even below the levels of channel beds. A fast water runoff from the fields also causes rapid soil drying. It is not uncommon that we see a field drenched when it is raining, and just a few days later, we see the very same fields overdried. Professor Lappin, climatologist. After 1987, the average air temperature grew considerably even in Eastern Europe, and the highest temperature records have been occurring 5 times more often than the lowest temperature ones. My observations indicate that drainage, drying, and overheating of agricultural land represents one of the two main causes of the excessive increase in extreme temperature events in the last 3 decades. We have carried out a set of water seepage measurements on agricultural land after crops have been harvested. First, we simulated a 100 mm rainfall on a 10 meter squared plot of arable land, which was plowed 30 centimeters deep, adjusting the speed of rainfall so that water gradually soaked into pores above the plowed section of the land instead of running off of the plot. The simulated rain lasted for 2 hours and 35 minutes. We dug 6, 60, 50, 40, 30, 20, and 10 centimeter deep holes on several fields, and especially in tractor tracks, and 1 additional 10 centimeter deep hole at a plot of uncompressed soil. We simulated a 300 millimeter rainfall in each of these holes, making sure that the level of water in the holes did not exceed 10 centimeters from the bottom of the holes at any given moment. Water in the 60, 50, and 40 centimeter deep holes soaked the fastest. Water in the 30 centimeter deep hole and in the 10 centimeter hole dug into uncompressed soil took roughly the same time to soak. However, the 20 centimeter hole was able to retain only 17 millimeters of water in 3 hours. Moreover, the compressed 10-centimeter hole retained only as little as 5 millimeters of water in 3 hours. Hence, it can be claimed that the compressed soil layer prevented rainwater from soaking into the ground. We have also carried out comparative measurements on heavy and mid-heavy soils. Even though these soils took longer to drain water, they have absorbed it in the end. They have absorbed 5 to 20 millimeters of water in one day, which exceeds average daily precipitation levels in the given location several fold. I propose the following actions to be taken on agricultural land. First, plowing should be deep. An additional device should be installed behind the tractor wheels to loosen the soil after tractors compress it when they move over agricultural soil to sow or fertilize crops. Small, impermeable constructions should be built in draining ditches. These constructions should also have an opening allowing for the regulation of water levels in these ditches. I have built a number of similar constructions in 2010, and they are functioning perfectly to this day. The seriousness of the issue is well documented by numbers too. In Slovakia, the country in the heart of Europe with an area of 49,036 kilometers squared and a population of 5 million, there are 6,000 kilometers of draining ditches. That is almost the length of the Great Wall of China, which is 6,700 kilometers long. If we retained 2 cubic meters of water on average for each regular meter of ditches, the partially filled ditches would increase the groundwater levels in the surrounding fields. Provided that groundwater levels rise by 1.3 meters as far as 500 meters outwards on both sides of the ditch, and provided that 1 cubic meter of soil absorbs 350 liters of water on average in its pores, the total volume of water retained in the ditches and soil could amount to 2,742 million cubic meters, that is almost 3 million cubic meters of water. This can be compared to 1/10 of the capacity of the Hoover Dam in the United States, the largest dam in the world. All of this at minimum costs. Water retained in such a way is priceless for the landscape as the system of regulation of water levels in ditches and channels allows us to slow down groundwater discharge, regulate groundwater levels in the surrounding fields, protect areas from floods and droughts, improve hydrological regimes on plains, renew biodiversity and climate stability. Moreover, it would also contribute to a more stable occurrence of precipitation events. Forests, streams, rivers, and dams. Warm air from the drained and overheated fields in lowlands rises into higher layers of the atmosphere, pushing clouds over colder mountain areas where, consequently, a higher occurrence of extreme precipitation events has been recorded in recent years. The natural rainwater retention ability of forests decreases every year because of extensive building of forest roads and due to uncontrollable growth of compressed soil areas in forests. It all began when heavy machinery, caterpillars, and track vehicles started to be used in forests more in the 1970s, with the aim to ensure higher profits and efficiency. Since then, water runoff from forests has increased significantly. And it has been since then that climatologists have started to note further rapid increases in Earth's surface temperatures. The soil in forests has been compressed even more rapidly in recent years. We have been increasingly using wood in the form of splinters incinerated by heating plants as a renewable source of energy. Therefore, logging has increased excessively too. And that was the second factor behind the record-breaking heat waves occurring since 1987. Treetops retain rainwater in forests. Subsequently, the water travels down through leaves, branches, and tree trunks into forest soil. and pores in soil transport it even further to places where there are no tree roots. Yet, there are many places in forests that have remained dry even despite long-term rains. Strangely, water often runs off from forests over compressed ground areas, which are found next to these dry parts of the forests. If there is an inclined forest road running along the tree line, water is discharged along root systems, taking soil with it, which results in tree root bearing. Forest owners and keepers leave the soil devastated after logging with an easy conscience. Yet this devastated ground speeds up the discharge of water from the forest. Many countries even have laws stipulating that compressed soil should be restored to its original state after logging, so that it is capable of retaining water again. However, this is not being done, and so the area of compressed soil keeps on growing. Yet compressed surfaces are not the only problem in forests and hilly terrains. Furrows created by heavy machinery also break off the continuity of pores found in soil. The best time to see the amount of water discharged through these pores in man-made slopes is when the snow melts. The water from melting snow in forests soaks into ground, which does not freeze during winter. Then, through broken pores, it gets to the surface again and runs off from the forests. Here you can see how the soil on slopes dries out from the top downwards. The top 4 meters of the slope have already been drained and are dry. In the pores in the lower part of the slope still is some water, which is being discharged from the forest above the slope. This is a clear example of how we are gradually drying our forests. The irreplaceable reservoirs of drinking water for fauna and flora on our planet. Mountains and hills crossed by forest roads and man-made slopes above them are thus sentenced to gradual draining, with fertile soil being washed away and all living organisms dying. Such hills are unable to retain a single drop of water. Water, which was supposed to be present in the slopes as far as 100 meters above the forest road, as well as the entire forest itself, is now not there. Regardless of whether the forest in question is a coniferous or a broad-leaved one, broken pores will dry them both. And we go further. We affect areas where logging is not done due to the steepness of the slopes as well. Road and highway construction sites illustrate this fact perfectly. Here, we do not even consider the water retention of soil. Instead, we are doing our best to get rid of it as quickly as possible, forming ideal conditions for the water to run off. Water discharged from the slopes above highways cannot be retained by stone walls or geological grates. For example, even this hill will be drained and will dry out gradually due to the highway construction. After such major interventions, it does not take long time for a catastrophe to happen. And floods and droughts are not the only form it can come in. Landslides. Landslides happen in hilly terrain during rains. A landslide occurs when water flowing over compressed soil on a forest road or a track reaches the uncompressed ground at the road bend or at the lowest point of the road. Here, the water drenches the soil, which under the weight of the water slides down, taking along the slope, surrounding trees, as well as the forest road that has caused the landslide itself. Drenched soil destroys everything underneath it. In the summer of 2014, after some heavy rains, a number of landslides occurred in the Slovak mountains above the Vratna village, burying the lower station and the local cableway. These pictures serve to prove that small landslides, with an area of up to 100 meters squared, occurred immediately below the forest tracks. When I walked along similar tracks, I have found that the soil in these tracks was significantly compressed. It was soil like this that provided for large quantities of water to flow over it to uncompressed grounds. There, the water drenched the soil, which then slid under the weight of the water. The bottom edge of the slide remained unaffected. Larger landslides were caused by tourist paths, which at some places were as wide as 16 meters. You may be wondering how a tourist path can be 16 meters wide. The answer is human laziness. Trying to avoid stony surfaces, tourists have widened the originally narrow tourist track to an unbelievable 16 meters, compressing it at the same time. The water that fell on these paths, which were sometimes as wide as highways, in a short period of time immediately flowed down the slopes with 35 to 45 degree inclines, leaving marks in the form of crushed stone and flattened grass. Basically, what happened was that dozens of tons of water have forced drenched soil out of the slopes, letting it slide into the valley down below. The foots of these hills were thoroughly eroded as high as 2 to 3 meters, and the soil above them remained intact. Obviously, extreme precipitation also contributed to the catastrophe, yet heavy rains have not occurred here by chance either. Warm air rising from drained lowlands prevented clouds from spreading over a greater piece of land and pushed them over hilly terrain, which was cooler. Thanks to the spreading of compressed soil areas and man-made slopes, agricultural lands and forests lose their ability to accumulate rainwater. Therefore, the amount of water retained in the soil decreases every day. Subsequently, streams are not fed by this water and dry out. Water is present in them only when it rains or when snow melts. When there is a lack of rain or snow, rivers are filled only to one-third of the levels recorded some 30 to 40 years ago in Slovakia, in summer and winter both. When there is no rain, two-thirds of the volume of water is missing. This means that continental groundwater levels today are much lower than in the past. Empty riverbeds are gradually overgrowing with trees and shrubs. Rivers are filled with water only when it rains or when the snow is melting. The situation with water reservoirs is similar. When it rains, reservoirs are full. With no rain, they are empty. Here we can see the amount of fertile soil being washed away from fields and forests. We are talking about thousands of tons. In some cases, entire forests are already growing in some empty reservoirs. Forests deprived of water also cause the following. Drying of forest flora, mainly spruces, which have shallow root systems. Forest calamities, as without water, tree roots lose elasticity, making trees more likely to fall. Forest fires. The following sign is usually placed at the entrance to forests in Slovakia. Dear visitors, welcome. This area is administered by the state enterprise Forests of the Slovak Republic. We are creating water resources, protecting soil, filtering air, and producing wood by protecting, cultivating, and renewing forest flora. Forests are a sanctuary of harmony and health we all need. Yet the dry stream on the right, behind the bar, serves to prove that no water sources are being created here. The only thing that happens here is logging, resulting in man-made slopes and compressed soil areas draining the forests irreversibly. Forests are no longer a renewable source of water and green energy. They are no longer a sanctuary of harmony and health. I propose the following measures to be taken. Compressed soil on logging tracts that are no longer in use and soil in furrows created by heavy machinery should be treated with excavators, starting from the top of the slope proceeding towards the bottom, preventing water from flowing off of them in order to retain rainwater in the place where it fell, allowing it to soak into the ground naturally. Man-made slopes above unused and already recultivated and compressed areas must be treated with machinery as deep as 1.5 meters to allow water discharge from pores to soak into the treated soil of the slope, gradually forming new pores, allowing the water to flow into deeper layers of the ground. I have implemented similar measures in Ukraine and in three locations in Slovakia. Measurements carried out by the Slovak Academy of Sciences have proven that not a single drop of water has flown out of these areas in the 3 years' time since these soil treatment measures have been implemented. These measures are immediately effective, sustainable, and much more important for the nature of mankind than the erection of dams and polders, and their costs are minimal. The ground above the man-made slopes, roads, logging tracks, and highways should be treated or plowed with machinery at a width of approximately 1 meter and a depth of approximately 2 to 4 meters along the contour lines some 5 to 20 meters above the man-made slope. Impervious foil should be placed at the bottom of dug holes during the ground treatment process, so that the water in the treated soil does not soak into pores below the treated ground. Water flowing off the slopes will then be absorbed by the treated soil and gradually by pores in lower layers further down the slope. So that the water in the treated soil does not soak into pores below the treated ground. When treating beds of streams and rivers flowing through cities and villages, I suggest cascades instead of using concrete to solidify riverbeds, as can be seen here. Cascades will allow for the life to continue in the streams. These adjustments were implemented on the same brook just 500 meters apart. A solution I have proposed to one businessman is also a good example of how water can be retained without a negative impact on human activities. Illegal waste dumps were found on the dried out marsh not far away from an industrial area in 2009. Rainwater from the entire area was unused and drained directly into the nearby river, which had a negative impact on the natural environment in the plant's vicinity. I have proposed a plan to retain the rainwater in artificial lakes. The plan was carried out in 2010, and now the area looks like this. Every drop of water which falls here is retained in the lakes, which have been created, giving life to plants and animals. It is not by chance that we have four seasons in a year in the northern and southern hemispheres. Autumns and winters are important when it comes to accumulating water in the soil from rainwater or melting snow. During springs and summers, this accumulated water feeds streams, rivers, flora, and fauna of the land. Yet perhaps unknowingly, we are doing our best to make the water from the land run off. If we stopped draining the land, we will stop climate change, global warming, melting of glaciers and ice caps, rising of ocean levels, floods and droughts. I have presented my findings and over 40 years of experience with soil and water at a number of national and international conferences worldwide in the past 5 years. All this time, not a single person has challenged the causes of climate change, global warming, melting of glaciers, rising of ocean levels, floods, droughts, and other catastrophes I have identified. Similarly, no one has challenged the solutions I have been proposing. Yet even in spite of this, it seems to me as if the generations shaping the life on this planet are not willing to see or solve the real problems, even though they keep talking about them. Although it might be that they just put the cart before the horse. As an example, I can mention a conference held on the premises of the UN in Geneva in May 2013. After my presentation during the plenary session, Secretary General of the World Meteorological Organization, Mr. Michel Girard, stated, "Perhaps scientists failed to notice something. Perhaps they have made a mistake somewhere. But if they made a mistake, they will remove it." Despite the statement, the ones in charge have not taken any steps to change the situation, which deteriorates year by year. Time is our biggest enemy. Every human being wants to leave a footprint, a trace which he will be remembered by when that human being is no longer here. It is our nature. People have been erecting barrows and monuments since time immemorial. Let us be the first generation to realize that covering our planet with opulent monuments is a road to hell. We too have a chance to leave a permanent trace, a message that will live on. Let us be the ones to give back the soil and water their worthy place in our ecosystems. It does not take much. We only have to admit some obvious facts, make the right global decisions, and start working to this end. Let us forget about our fear of responsibility. Solutions exist, and they are often much easier than one would expect. We only need to look around and pay attention to what we see. The future of our planet is in our hands.